por Jaleel Montero, un estudiante de Mount Haven Community High School. Good afternoon, everyone. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, which will be recited by Mount Haven Community High School student Jaleel Montero.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Por favor, permanezcan de pie por Imam Talib Abdul Rashid, quien dará la invocación de hoy. Please remain standing for Imam Talib Abdul Rashid, who will give today's invocation.
Peace be unto you all. Shalom. Salam. Almighty God, Ya Ilahin Nas, God of humanity, we of this nation of many hues, ethnicities, and nationalities call upon you during this hour of need for mercy, guidance, justice, and healing. For none has the power to grant our needs but you. And just as your word manifested as Jesus, the Son of Mary, proclaimed, as did your prophet Isaiah before him, peace be upon them both, saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. O Creator and Giver of life, save your creation, planet Earth, we pray, from the ravages of greed and neglect by your other creation, human beings. Oft forgiving God, we ask your forgiveness as members of the human family for our collective sin of oppression and bloodshed and violation of the sacredness of the life given by none but you. You have instructed us that when the life of one of us is saved, then it is as if the life of all of us has been saved. And when one of us is killed, it is as if all of us have been killed. Therefore, save us, we pray, from ourselves and from others. Comfort us for the loss of our family members. For Mike Brown is our family, and Eric Garner, and Khalif Browder, and Akai Gurley, Ramali Graham, and Amadou Diallo, Anthony Baez, Anthony Rosario, Hilton Vega, Muhammad Ba, and so many others. And Tanisha Anderson, and Tariqa Wilson, and Rakia Boyd, and Sandra Bland, and Gidon Gary Bush, or our family. Let us remember always, Almighty God, those dedicated police officers who lost their lives protecting and serving our community, for they too are members of our family, like Randolph Holder, Wei Jin Liu, and Rafael Ramos. We seek your forgiveness, remembering all genocide, all enslavement, all pogroms and lynchings, all fire and ash in southern Manhattan, or nuclear fire in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And just as your servant and messenger Muhammad commanded us to free the captive, feed the hungry, and visit the sick, guide us to the realization of this in our day, in this time and place, we pray. O God of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Alhaj Malik El Shabazz Malcolm X, cleanse our hearts and grant us the courage to confront and eradicate racism and to end poverty. O God of many names, we pray for freedom, justice, and equality for all people. And all of these things we pray in your holy name. Amen and amen.
Por favor, tome sus asientos y denle una bienvenida al líder de la mayoría del Consejo de la Ciudad de Nueva York, Jimmy Van Bramer. Please be seated and give a warm welcome to New York City Council Majority Leader, Jimmy Van Bramer.
Good afternoon. Y buenas tardes, Ciudad de Nueva York. Mr. Borough President Diaz, this is for you. Y un fuerte aplauso para el Bronx. Y amo todas las personas en el Bronx. I am proud to serve as the majority leader of this, the most diverse, progressive, collaborative, and reform-minded city council in history. And with the leadership of Speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito, we are making New York City a more fair and just place for all. Now, before I begin, I have the distinct honor of acknowledging some of our very special guests. I want to recognize public advocate Tish James is here with us today. City Comptroller Scott Stringer is with us here today. Manhattan Borough President Gail Brewer is with us today. Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams is here. And he's already had one shout out, but the Borough President of the Bronx, Ruben Diaz Jr. Our Bronx District Attorney, Darcel Clark, is with us today. And there are several members of Mayor de Blasio's administration who are here today. Commissioner Nisha Agarwal is with us today. Commissioner Vicky Bean is here today. Deputy Mayor Richard Bury. I believe I saw Deputy Mayor Herminia Palacios. I see our school's chancellor, Carmen Farina, has joined us. And we will also recognize State Senator Gustavo Rivera, who I see here. And our DDC Commissioner, Dr. Fenioski Peña Mora, is here. Let's give a big round of applause to all the members of the de Blasio administration who are here with us today. So this council and the members of the New York City Council are seated here to my left, believe in public service and work every day to improve the lives of our constituents and the people of our city. Let's give a big round of applause to the members of the New York City Council. Now, I can't come to the Bronx and talk about this council's diversity without highlighting the fact that our LGBT caucus expanded recently. And I know from firsthand experience that coming out is both exhilarating and frightening at the same time. So let all of us, in one voice, thank and congratulate our friend, Bronx's own Jimmy Vaca, for sharing his authentic self. Congratulations, Jimmy. Now, Tish James just said I should sing I'm Coming Out. I will not be doing that, just in case you were wondering. But I will be referencing another song. So before introducing each of my colleagues individually, let me share a few thoughts about speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito. And let me use the lyrics to one of her favorite songs, Vivir Mi Vida, Mark Anthony's anthem to living our lives. How many folks love Mark Anthony and Vivir Mi Vida? And if you think I'm singing this, Tish James, I'd like to sell you the Throgs Neck Bridge. But I think the lyrics are actually poignant and actually speak to Melissa Mark-Viverito's heart. Voy a vivir el momento para entender el destino. I'm going to live in this moment to understand my destiny. Voy a escuchar en silencio para encontrar el camino. I'm going to listen in the silence to find my path. Voy a reír, voy a gozar, vivir mi vida. La, 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 as everyone knows. I'm going to laugh. I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to live my life. Speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito, the first Latina speaker, is a woman of destiny. She listens, she searches for truth, and she acts, seizing this moment in her journey, not only to live her life, but to allow others to live theirs. A big round of applause for Speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito. So now allow me to introduce all of the members of the City Council who are here that I have been given the names of and that I can see who are here as I just saw another member arrive. But let me say and thank all of them, and let's all of us thank all of them. Council Member Fernando Cabrera. Councilmember Margaret Chin. Councilmember Andrew Cohen. I see Councilmember Costa Constantinides. Councilmember Lori Cumbo, who brought her own cheering squad. Councilmember Inez Dickens. Councilmember Danny Drum. Yeah. Councilmember Matthew Eugene. Yeah. Councilmember Julissa Ferreras Copeland. Yeah. Councilmember Vincent Gentile. Yeah. Councilmember Vanessa Gibson. Councilmember David Greenfield. Councilmember Barry Gradenchik. And I'm from Queens, so I can say that right, Barry. Councilmember Ben Kalos. Councilmember Peter Koo. Councilmember Karen Kozlowitz. Councilmember Rory Lanceman. Councilmember Brad Lander. Councilmember Steve Levin. Councilmember Mark Levine. Councilmember Rosie Mendez. And proving that this is not all on the list, and I'm doing it as I see you, Councilmember Liz Crowley, I see you there. Councilmember Danique Miller? Yes, Danique Miller is here. Councilmember Antonio Reynoso. And now I see Councilmember Carlos Menchaca. Councilmember Donovan Richards. Councilmember Idanis Rodriguez. Councilmember Helen Rosenthal. Councilmember Richie Torres. Councilmember Mark Traeger. Councilmember Eric Ulrich. Councilmember Jimmy Vaca. Councilmember Jumani Williams. And I believe we saw everyone, right? Anyone get left out? No. All right, good. Ladies and gentlemen, the members of the New York City Council. So now it is my pleasure to introduce a tremendous young woman, Shatia Burks. Shatia Burks, you clap for her. Shatia Burks is a member of the New York City Council's Young Women's Initiative, serving as a member of the Young Women's Advisory Council. She is also a New York Latina Activist Network member with the National Latina Institute for Reproductive Health. Shatia became an advocate for runaway and homeless youth and young parents in New York City and has been featured on the Huffington Post. Her drive and passion for this work stems from her experiences as a teen parent when she had her son at the age of 19. Shatia manages to work long shifts on her jobs as a home health aide and a direct service professional. During her time working with the YWAC for the Young Women's Initiative, she contributed to the community support an opportunity working group. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Shatia Burks.
So I'm gonna give everyone a minute to have a seat. I see people in the back still standing. Yes. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Shatia Burks, but you can call me Powerful. I am a leader. I am a mother. I am an activist. I am a caregiver. I am a fighter. I am a provider. I am a young woman, but my journey is just beginning. Young women are the future of New York City. Our experiences, our voices, our lives will be a profound impact on how we grow the city, as a community, as a society. And we are rising to the challenge. We are blazing forward. We are making a change. But make no mistake, to be a young woman in our city and even our country is an uphill battle. For a young woman of color like me, it's been steeper. We are more than statistics, but statistics themselves are pretty alarming. If you're a woman of color, chances are your access to education, to healthcare, to justice, to equality have been impeded. You've probably been told you can't, that you won't, or that you shouldn't. You've probably been told no. But we want to change that. I want to change that. That's why I joined the Young Women's Advisory Council as a part of the New York City Young Women Initiative. To Together, we've been working hard to figure out how the city can be better support, invest, and serve the thousands of strong young women in New York City. We've been looking at how being a young woman intersects with race, with gender equity, sexual orientation, and other issues so that our full diversity is represented. We've been studying the experiences of young women in education, in civic life, in the justice system, and in the economy. And I can't wait for you to hear more. But here's one thing I can tell you now. We need more women to elect in office. We need more women like the one you're going to hear from today, New York City Council Speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito. She was born in Puerto Rico to a mom and dad who believed in social justice. Her father, a doctor, often treated patients who couldn't afford to pay. Her mother was very active in the Puerto Rican feminist movement, fighting for women's equality. Like me, Melissa has been fighting for women from an early age, pushing for workers' rights, building up the next generation of young leaders, and organizing her community around issues that make a difference in the lives of everyday people. And since she's become speaker, her commitment to young women has grown, making sure that the city has programs and policies that uplift women, supporting for women, own businesses, and funding for domestic violence survivors. She fights to empower women, whether it's equal pay for equal work, the right to choose, or for equality in our economic opportunities. It makes a difference in the lives of young women to know that we have a crucial role in our city. It's important for us, for everyone, to see this kind of diversity and strive toward more of it. It shows that we can too be the speaker, or the mayor, or the president, but we can do anything we want. Ladies and gentlemen, New York City Council Speaker Melissa Mark-Viverito.
Good afternoon to everyone. Shuprabat. I want to thank and say gracias very dearly to my Majority Leader, Jimmy Van Bramer. Thank you to Imam Talib Abdur Rashid for that moving invocation. Gracias to Jalil Montero for leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. And thank you to Principal Helene Spadaccini for having us here today. She's doing wonderful work here at Samuel Gompers, and we really thank her for her service. And of course, I have to say thank you to Shatia for that wonderful introduction. So, bienvenidos al campus Samuel Gompers in el sur del Bronx. Welcome to Samuel Gompers campus here in the South Bronx. In this special part of my district, we are proud to have St. Mary's Park, the largest park in the South Bronx, and home to the borough's very first playground. We've invested a lot to restore St. Mary's Park, and we've only just begun. Take a short walk south of here, and you can visit the green fields of Randall's Island by taking the brand new connector, one of our city's most recent landmarks. Also, don't forget to stop by Port Morris Distillery for the best pitorro this side of Puerto Rico. And my dear mommy was born in Lincoln Hospital and went to school not too far from here at Bronx Elementary School 75 and James N. Kiernan Junior High School. She's in the audience right now along with my brother Anthony. Hi, Mom. Now, you all know how much I love Twitter. And let's just say that it now runs in the family. So I'm sure my mom is going to be favoriting all your tweets, so make sure that you tweet and you tag her. Oh, no. She's going to take a photo. All right. Make sure you follow her. Now, the South Bronx, there she's going to wait. She's going to, okay, Ma. All right. Yes. I told you. The South Bronx has been at the center of the fight for urban America. This is a community where you grow up hearing the familiar sounds of double Dutch rhymes and dominoes. This is a place where people have pushed back against pollution and neglect and fought tirelessly for environmental justice. Not too long ago, the people of the South Bronx were largely left to fend for themselves. While many turned their backs on the Bronx, this community never wavered. Instead, they fought. Today, the revival of the South Bronx is a great American success story. Its strength and vibrancy are rooted in this community's incredible spirit and manifested in its culture and art. Not too far from here, in a nondescript building on Sedgwick Avenue, hip-hop was born. Young people channeled their creativity and talent into hip-hop and expressed poignant commentary on everything from social conditions to neighborhood pride and drug awareness. It was art born out of vision and struggle. The struggle for equality, the struggle for fairness, and the struggle along the March for Justice, the same arc the great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. talked about. It is fitting then that we're in a building named after another iconic pioneer in that fight for justice, Samuel Gompers. An immigrant who settled in New York City, Samuel Gompers dedicated his life to workers. An 8-hour workday, fair wages, better workplace conditions. All of these are hard-fought pieces of his legacy. A legacy that lives on to this day in the fight for 15, paid sick leave, and paid family leave. He also said, "We need more justice and less revenge. Más justicia y menos venganza." One year ago in El Barrio, this council laid out an ambitious agenda to lift every voice. Our efforts have focused on sweeping aside long-standing injustices, righting systemic wrongs, and giving voice to the voiceless. Because of this council, we've banned the box and expanded access to representation in civil court, keeping more New Yorkers in their homes. Because of this council, our brave veterans have a department to call their own. And because of this council, New York City is leading the dialogue on immigration and criminal justice reform. This is a council of action. Time and again, we are ahead of the curve. And that's because of who we are. The 51 men and women of this city council who together represent 8.5 million New Yorkers. We are LGBT, and have you heard, we're even more so this year than last year. We're also allies. We are activists. We are living with HIV. We are caregivers, immigrants, and the formerly homeless. We are diverse. We speak Creole, Hebrew, Russian, Mandarin, Yiddish, y también español. We are New York City. Somos diversos, somos la ciudad de Nueva York. And so to all of my colleagues in the council, I say gracias, thank you. With our ear firmly to the ground, We've identified problems and found solutions. We've set up communities for success with an unwavering focus on social and economic justice, and taken on tough issues that were neglected for far too long. And yes, along the way, we've rocked the boat a few times. But you can't have change without challenge. While we're proud of what we've done, our work continues. The state of the city is strong, but its foundation must be strengthened. That foundation is New Yorkers themselves. It's you. It's the student eager to vote, or the community fighting for more green space. It's the immigrant family starting a business, or the single mother bringing her baby home for the first time. It's our city's seniors and their caregivers. It's the New Yorker struggling to find a home, or the young man languishing at Rikers. And it is every young woman looking up at the glass ceiling. Son los neoyorquinos los que hacen de esta una gran ciudad. Y son los neoyorquinos quienes necesitan más justicia. It's New Yorkers who make New York great. And it's New Yorkers who need more justice. This year, we will begin by kickstarting the heartbeat of our democracy, civic engagement. We've already seen how innovations in voting systems can bring New Yorkers to the polls. One of this council's proudest achievements is the expansion of participatory budgeting. PB is a laboratory for what an enfranchised voting populace is all about. And this year, we are proud to announce that Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams, who is here with us today, hi Eric, will be pledging $1 million for the City Council's participatory budgeting process. So I want to thank the Borough President. In the City Council's last PB cycle, we tested diverse strategies to bring democracy to voters, including reminder texts that say when, where, and how to cast a PB ballot. The result was unprecedented participation across all sectors of our city, especially among our youth. In fact, 12% of the total PB ballots that were cast by New Yorkers under the age of 18. New York City's youth are eager to get involved. We just need to provide them with the opportunities. That is why the council will fund civic engagement programs so students can advocate for issues that matter in their communities. And we will expand support for voter registration drives in our city's high schools with the goal of registering 10,000 students to vote. Here with us today are students from across our city, young people who will not only inherit the city, but play a defining role in its future. Our young people can and should be a powerful voice in the next election. Voting is the most basic and essential act in our democracy, but the truth is, too few of us bother to do it. New York State, listen to this, New York State ranked 49th in the nation for voter participation in the 2014 elections. Just 29% of eligible voters went to the polls. Part of the blame for low voter turnout rests with antiquated voting laws that have failed to keep up with improvements. Antiquated voting laws that have failed to keep up with improvements seen in other states. This is why the council will push for key innovations that will make it easier to vote. In order to achieve significant election reforms, we need action at the state level. Governor Cuomo made this a priority in his state of the state, and we will support him. Imagine being able to vote early or walking into your polling place and registering to vote on the spot, right? Even better, imagine if registration was automatic. The public cannot stand up and be counted if we fail to modernize our voting process. Now, at the city level, we can do this by embracing technology. The council will work to create a voting app and online portal that will allow users to find their polling place, get election information, check their registration, track absentee ballot information, and much more. To increase turnout, we're also going to create voter notifications through email and text messaging, just like we've successfully done with PB. We are going to bring democracy right to your fingertips, because we get it. New Yorkers are busy, and it's easy to believe your vote won't make a difference. But it does. And not all the solutions to problems in our voting system are high tech. It's also as simple as making sure old polling locations have directions to new ones. We're also going to create meaningful opportunities for young people to gain experience in local government. Many New Yorkers who complete graduate school feel drawn to public service, only to find dead ends. Every year, we lose out on talented young professionals who have so much to offer our city. New York must do a better job of recruiting and training social workers, lawyers, policy analysts, and others who are committed to advancing social justice through city government. We will harness their passion and creativity by creating a social justice post-grad fellowship in New York City. Its goal will be simple: give a diverse, talented group of young professionals more opportunities to engage in public service. We will place graduates with professional degrees throughout city government so they can put their expertise to work. And someday, a graduate of this program may even lead our great city. We need to recommit ourselves to a simple yet powerful notion. New York needs to be a city for everyone, with policymaking and governance that is open to everyone. We need to have more voices at the decision-making table. That is why the City Council will bring more justice to communities so they can make informed land use decisions. Neighborhoods across New York City are in the midst of rezoning discussions. Planning for the future of our neighborhoods should start from the ground up. And infuse the voices of everyday New Yorkers into policy decisions. This process presents a critical opportunity to discuss real neighborhood concerns and needs, from school overcrowding and pedestrian safety to sewers and public transit. So the council proposes that the city develop a neighborhood commitment plan to accompany rezoning proposals, describing and tracking commitments for housing, schools, infrastructure, and other city services. If we make a promise to a community, then we should keep it. That is why we must also overhaul our so-called fair share system for siting city services. Not the sexiest topic, but important nonetheless. Fair share is supposed to mean a more equitable distribution of important services throughout the city. The things everyone wants near them, like libraries and daycare, and the services people often don't want nearby, but our communities still need, like waste transfer stations or drug treatment centers. Our fair share guidelines are vague and difficult to enforce. They haven't been updated in 25 years. And there is limited information available to the public to inform these critical decisions. Too often, less desirable facilities are concentrated in just a few communities, like this one in the South Bronx. That is not enough justice. So the council will empower neighborhoods by working with our partners in city and state government. We are in a school after all. Wow.
Thank you.
That was great. Critical services needed in our neighborhoods, like our public schools. So the council will empower neighborhoods by working with our partners in city and state government to create tools and improve opportunities for public input in the fair share process, making the system more fair for everyone. We will also explore using land use and other tools like tax incentives to keep New York City affordable, diverse, and vibrant in the face of increasing pressures on our small businesses. Mom and pop shops are the economic heart of our city. Essential, yes. They are essential to the character and diversity of our neighborhoods. But skyrocketing real estate prices mean that when small businesses have to renew their leases, they often face significant and unaffordable rent increases, forcing many to relocate or close completely. Too many storefronts are allowed to stay vacant for months on the speculation that they will be able to attract deeper pocketed tenants. This is what leads to the kind of cookie cutter retail that is proliferating in our most diverse neighborhoods, creating a sameness that represents none of what makes New York City unique. So this year, the council will launch a planning study to develop recommendations for strengthening our small business community through land use policy and other tools such as tax incentives. This work will give neighborhoods the opportunity to create new strategies for protecting retail diversity. Nearly half of New York City's small businesses are immigrant-owned. Immigration is our past, it is our present, and I can assure you, it will be our future. We only need to look around this community to see how immigration has shaped us. La inmigración es nuestro pasado, es nuestro presente, y les aseguro que será nuestro futuro. Somos una ciudad de inmigrantes. We are an immigrant city. Within our five boroughs, you will find New Yorkers from all over the world, speaking hundreds of languages. But over the past few months, the immigrant city has come under attack. On the campaign trail, immigrants have been denigrated, have been humiliated, and dehumanized. They say build a wall. They say kick them all out. And they call them illegal. Ningún ser humano es ilegal. No human is illegal. Compañeros, fear and hate may be strong, but love and acceptance are much, much stronger. El amor es más fuerte que el odio. New York is proud to be a sanctuary city. We are proud that IDNYC is the most successful municipal ID in the country. We're proud that every unaccompanied minor has a lawyer. We're proud that we've removed ICE from Rikers. And we will continue to build on our successes. We all know how difficult navigating government can be. Now imagine how frustrating it is if you don't fully speak the language. Our language access law is due for an upgrade. And let me be clear, this means more than translation services. We need to do a better job communicating effectively with all of our communities. We must ensure that city agencies are developing appropriate language access plans, designating language access coordinators, and utilizing interpreters. So the council will pass legislation making sure agencies gather information on the language needs and demographics of people accessing direct public services, so they have a better understanding of the communities they serve. Once implemented, we will require agencies to provide translation services in the top 6 languages their clients speak. Harnessing technology, the council will also work with our partners in city government to ensure emergency push notifications come in multiple languages. Finally, we will use the power of information to increase access to financial health and the affordable housing system. So the council will establish consumer financial education campaigns for target populations, including immigrants, seniors, and women, along with financial literacy outreach teams in neighborhoods with new opportunities for affordable housing. This ambitious program will help countless individuals and families who have found themselves on the outside looking in. El no saber inglés nunca debe ser un obstáculo para acceder servicios de la ciudad. English proficiency should never be an obstacle to accessing city services. This council is in the business of removing barriers, barriers that have historically blocked New Yorkers from opportunities and success. For many young families, getting a healthy start in life can be a challenge. We know that prenatal and early childhood stages of development are critical, shaping a child's ability to learn, build relationships, and grow. Conversely, we also know that disparities during early childhood in nutrition, education, home life, and more are magnified over time and often have long-term negative consequences. For expecting mothers, especially first-time mothers, poverty can be a major obstacle to a healthy pregnancy and the best possible start in life for their babies. Here in the Bronx, rates of infant mortality, low birth weights, teen pregnancy, and insufficient prenatal care vastly exceed those of the city and the state. Raising a child does take a village. And that's where we can help. The Nurse Family Partnership is an extremely successful nurse home visit program for low-income and other at-risk first-time mothers, providing valuable support during pregnancy until the child's second birthday. Building on its success, the council proposes an $8 million expansion of the Nurse Family Partnership. By intervening early, we can eliminate many of the risk factors and challenges that complicate pregnancy and child rearing. The Nurse Family Partnership has reduced infant deaths, prevented substance abuse and addiction for both mother and child, and curbed child abuse and neglect. When something works and works as profoundly as the Nurse Family Partnership, we must support its expansion. Esto es más justicia para las familias. This is more justice for families. To further support our city's families, we must also increase our investment in after-school programming for elementary school students. These programs provide children with enrichment opportunities and a nurturing place to go after school, while allowing hundreds of thousands of parents to balance jobs with family responsibilities. And as we care for our youngest New Yorkers, we must also support our seniors, who are the anchors of our communities. That is why we must also meet the enormous challenge of creating a dignified and sustainable system that allows our city to care for them. This council has consistently fought for New York City's 1.5 million seniors by funding senior centers throughout the five boroughs and increasing the income limits for the SCRE program so that thousands more seniors can afford to stay in their homes. With our aging population on the rise, it is incumbent on our city to ensure that our mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, and grandparents receive the care and companionship they need to age with dignity. And that includes providing support for their caregivers. We know that so many New Yorkers are struggling to balance the commitments of work while helping to make sure their elderly loved ones get to the doctor's office, eat a home-cooked meal, or simply have an arm to hold while walking in the park. So the council will pass legislation requiring the city to develop a comprehensive plan to identify the needs of our caregiver population and to improve services and programs that will assist them. We will also establish a division of paid care within the newly created Office of Labor Standards, ensuring that workers in the caregiver industry have the supports they need to provide the best care for our seniors, children, and disabled family members. Finally, the council will put more money in New Yorkers' pockets by working with the state to expand the city's child care tax credit. While simultaneously enhancing it to include adults who are unable to care for themselves. And we will continue our fight for paid family leave. Para asegurar un futuro brillante, la ciudad tiene que invertir en más servicios y programas para los niños y las familias. In order to secure a bright future, the city must make these important investments in services and programming for children and families. Unfortunately, for many families, poverty doesn't mean cutting back or saving more. Poverty is the terrible choice between putting food on the table and making that month's rent, between paying hospital bills and having nothing left over to live on. Every night, over 58,000 New Yorkers sleep in the city's shelter system. Over 3,000 more face the cold on the street, unsheltered. This has been a growing challenge for decades. It's a challenge that we as a city are committed to addressing. It's easy to paint a simplified picture of homelessness. We might imagine someone who is jobless, or perhaps someone who is struggling with their mental health. And in many cases, that might be part of the story. But here is the truth. For thousands of New Yorkers, the only thing standing between them and homelessness is one missed paycheck, or one unforeseen medical emergency. And with costs of living on the rise, these stories are becoming more and more common. We have a moral, a humanitarian, and a legal obligation to end the city's systemic homelessness crisis. The council is proud to play a key role in that fight. We provided over $11 million in funding for anti-eviction legal services and emergency assistance for families in danger of becoming homeless. And we've passed legislation making it easier for domestic violence survivors to qualify for shelter. But clearly, more must be done. Necesitamos más justicia. We need more justice. Para empezar, tenemos que aumentar el salario mínimo. First, we need to raise the minimum wage. Under Mayor de Blasio's leadership, New York City has raised the minimum wage to $15 an hour for city workers. We should thank them, yes. And Governor Cuomo has called for a $15 minimum wage across the state, a momentous decision that would uplift countless families. This is a huge step, and now Albany must act. As for the city's ability to provide appropriate housing for those in need, support from the federal government is critical, especially Section 8. This federal program provides subsidies for eligible low-income families to rent decent, safe, and affordable housing. But the demand for these vouchers far outpaces the supply. So this council calls on Congress today to recommit to and expand Section 8. Homelessness is a national problem, and the federal government must do its part. At the city level, we can act decisively by creating our own expansive, permanent rental subsidy program. Such a program would stop families from re-entering the shelter system due to the increasing gap between wages and rent. And recipients and property owners alike would benefit from knowing there was a consistent support system in place, one that wouldn't automatically cease after a few years. We all know that our city is growing less and less affordable. It is unrealistic for many families to go from living in shelter to making full rent payments after only a few years of temporary assistance. A permanent subsidy would help establish stability by preventing families from cycling in and out of shelters, maintaining people in their communities, and keeping children in their schools. We also call on the state to do its part and allocate adequate funding for this important program. And together, the city and the state should accelerate their commitment to develop thousands of units of supportive housing. As the largest source of permanent affordable housing in our city, the New York City Housing Authority plays a pivotal role in fighting homelessness. In 2015, almost 1,700 formerly homeless families moved into public housing, and NYCHA connected nearly 1,000 homeless families and veterans with Section 8 housing. Pero podemos hacer más. We can do more. So the council calls on the administration to allocate additional public housing units for homeless families, including survivors of domestic violence. We are in the middle of an unprecedented crisis that requires immediate solutions, and providing more NYCHA housing is something the city can implement in the short term. Nadie debe vivir en las calles. No one should live on the street. Everyone deserves a stable home. Yeah. New York City is committed to taking on institutional injustice wherever we find it. We are one of the safest cities in the world. That safety is ensured by the brave men and women of our diverse NYPD. I especially want to thank PSA 5, PSA 7, the 23rd, 25th, and 40th precincts who are here with us today. They deserve our respect and appreciation, and we join them in continuing to mourn the deaths of Detective Brian Moore, who was killed protecting the people of Queens, and Detective Randolph Holder, who lost his life protecting East Harlem. Whether it's adding new officers to the force or funding bullet-resistant vests, this council is proud to support the NYPD. We also understand that we must continue the quest for reform. Our support for the NYPD and our efforts to improve the criminal justice system are not mutually exclusive. In fact, they go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. One year ago, we set out to create a system where the penalties fit the crime, where you don't end up at Rikers because you can't afford $500 bail, where a prior arrest does not unjustly prevent you from getting a job, and where committing a low-level, non-violent offense does not land you in jail or give you a permanent criminal record. Más justicia y menos venganza. More justice, less revenge. The council is seeking to achieve more justice for New Yorkers through the Criminal Justice Reform Act. The CJRA will ensure there are fairer, more proportionate enforcement and penalties for low-level offenses. Because giving someone a permanent criminal record for being in a park after dark is simply not fair or proportionate. And spending the night in jail on a 10-year-old warrant for being in the park after dark, it's not just unfair, it's senseless. Yet this is exactly what is happening every day in our city, thanks to the over 1.5 million active summons warrants on our books. This makes even less sense now, since under the Criminal Justice Reform Act, that person would likely receive only a civil penalty for the violation, with no possibility of a warrant, no possibility of a criminal record, and no possibility of spending the night in jail. That is why our next step must be to reform our warrant system. Old warrants for minor, nonviolent offenses have hung needlessly over too many people's heads for far too long. So the council will work with our partners to create a system to clear old summons warrants for those who have spent years, even decades, out of trouble. But even after we clear old warrants, there will still be hundreds of thousands left on the books. So we will increase outreach to communities to inform people about outstanding warrants and provide them with more opportunities to address their situation the right way without spending a night in jail. We are also going to help victims of crimes. Too often, people simply don't know where to turn to for help. So the council will create the Crime Victim Services Coordinator within the Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice. The coordinator will work across city agencies and with service providers to make sure victims have the help they need. The council will also target persistent pockets of crime by passing legislation, ensuring that the city has a multi-agency plan to provide social services in these areas. By addressing underlying problems, such as unemployment, high school dropout rates, or drug and alcohol abuse, we can work toward reducing crime. We will also pass legislation improving the quality of life through the creation of targeted neighborhood support teams, an approach that has already worked in East Harlem. Over 2 years ago, my office began organizing monthly community stakeholder meetings to address quality of life issues in my neighborhood. Last year, I led a number of commissioners on a walkthrough around 125th Street and Lexington Avenue, and we began having regular discussions with city agencies. And I thank Mayor de Blasio for working with us so closely to tackle these issues. Together, we have seen improvements in street cleanliness, built a new pedestrian plaza, and address the K2 epidemic head-on through legislation, enforcement, and the delivery of health services. This coordinated approach will be used as a model to address the varied and often unique quality of life concerns experienced by other communities throughout the city. By focusing at a local level, we can begin to address the systemic issues that plague neighborhoods and actually start to fix them. We will also take this targeted approach with our city's jail facilities. Last year, the council passed 8 pieces of legislation creating real transparency at Rikers. This year, we will continue to shine the spotlight on our city's jail system by passing legislation establishing an inspector general for the Department of Correction. The Inspector General will focus on systemic issues in the city's jail system and will be modeled after the successful NYPD Inspector General established by the City Council in 2013. Every year, there are about 70,000 admissions to Rikers and other city jails, but only about 16% of those admitted are ultimately sentenced to prison. As we know, even a short stay at Rikers can be harmful. As a result, many fall into an endless cycle of recidivism. And the deeper you fall into that cycle, the more difficult it is to get out. Many lose hope in themselves and in the system itself. Si hay neoyorquinos que sienten que no tienen esperanza en el futuro, esa es nuestra falla. If there are New Yorkers today who feel they have no hope for a future, that is our failure. Reducing recidivism must be a top priority. To start, the council will work with the Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice to create a municipal division of transition services. This division will help those re-entering our communities to get back on their feet through computer classes, resume building, drug treatment, housing resources, and more. We will continue to expand programming at Rikers to support rehabilitation and to reduce the amount of conflict that occurs when there is too much idle time. And we know that maintaining community ties has been proven to reduce recidivism. So the council will develop a video visitation program for those who are incarcerated, so families can go to a local library or a neighborhood center and talk to their loved ones or even read together when they can't make the day-long trip to Rikers Island. And we will continue to demand that the state raise the age of criminal responsibility. It is a travesty that our 16 and 17-year-old children are automatically treated as adults in our criminal justice system when they should be dealt with in family court. New York is one of only two states left in this country that still does this, and it is shameful. Qué vergüenza. Treating 16 and 17-year-old children like adults builds cycles of revenge and ruins too many lives. A little more than a year ago, the world was introduced to a young man from the Bronx named Khalif Browder. Khalif was 16 years old when he was sent to Rikers to await trial. The fair and speedy trial that we are promised in the Constitution. That trial would never come. Instead, Khalif languished in Rikers for 3 years. Sitting in solitary confinement for almost two of those years, he endured unspeakable psychological and physical abuse. He was never even convicted of a crime, and the charges were eventually dropped. But it was too late. Khalif entered as a child, but left as a broken man. A few months later, Khalif died by his own hands. It was not one failure which led to his death. It was generations of failures compounded on one another. There are certainly other Khalifs out there. Young people who have left Rikers so damaged by their interaction with the system that they reoffend, relapse, or worse. Mrs. Browder, I want to thank you for being here today. Our current Riker-centric system has been plagued by a culture of violence requiring federal oversight. It is also wildly inefficient. Necesitamos más justicia en el sistema de justicia. We need more justice in the justice system. Far from the courthouses, it regularly costs the Department of Correction $25 million per year just to transport inmates. And if you want to visit friends or family or see an attorney, it typically takes them an entire day just to travel to Rikers and go through processing. This system keeps those who have been accused of committing crimes out of sight and out of mind. It is time to take our criminal justice system out of the shadows and finally address the institutional racism which has plagued it for far too long. It is time to reimagine our entire criminal justice system. Today, I am announcing a new independent commission chaired by former Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman, who is here with us today. Which will explore a community-based justice model that will complement existing reform efforts. The commission will create a blueprint for justice for New York City. It will recommend ways to continue to reduce pretrial detention rates, and assess moving adolescents and those suffering from mental illness off Rikers in the short term. It will also look at utilizing more community courts and borough-based jail facilities. Rikers Island has come to represent our worst tendencies and our biggest failures. It is where Khalif suffered and his spirit broke down. For too long, Rikers has not stood for more justice, but for revenge. We must explore how we can get the population of Rikers to be so small that the dream of shutting it down becomes a reality. This is how we will get there. This is how we will bring more justice to New York City. Finally, I want to speak to all of you about a certain ceiling we keep hearing about, one that perpetuates inequality and thwarts access to education, healthcare, and economic opportunity. Of course, I'm talking about the glass ceiling. For young women, that glass ceiling is still too low. For young women of color, it's even lower. But you know what's great about glass? You can shatter it. And if you ask me, it's time to do just that. Necesitamos más justicia para las mujeres. We need more justice for women.
That's right.
Right here in the City Council, we have 14 strong women committed to serving their communities. Ladies, we are mighty and strong, but not enough. We have three women of color negotiating a city budget that will uplift millions of New Yorkers. But it's not enough. Of the 8 city council seats that will be vacated because of term limits in the next election, 5 are currently held by women. All women of color. We need to do better. We need more women leaders, women at the table making decisions, informing the discussions around issues so central to our everyday lives and the lives of our families. We need more women in elected office, so that when our government tries to make decisions about our bodies, our health care, our rights, that we can fight back. And we need more women-owned businesses, because financial literacy and independence go hand in hand. We need more gender parity in education so that no girl is told ever again that she can't do math, pursue a career in science, or become an astronaut. Empoderar a las mujeres significa empoderar a todos nosotros, creando una sociedad más fuerte, más saludable, y más justa. Empowering women means empowering all of us, creating a stronger, healthier, and more just society. That is why the New York City Council launched the Young Women's Initiative last year. This First in the Nation coalition was designed to examine the systemic, chronic inequality faced by many young women, and to figure out how to dismantle it. The Young Women's Initiative is a ladder of support, of investment, of opportunity for the young women in our city. Over the last several months, More than 200 advocates and policy experts convened at the council to examine the disparities experienced by young women and girls. We brought young women themselves to the table, like Shatia, the young woman who introduced me today, and we ensured that the process was inclusive of the experiences of trans women and gender nonconforming New Yorkers. We also met young people where they are, building a digital campaign with the hashtag SheWillBe or Ella Será to drive conversations. This process has produced important recommendations for our city to focus on in the future, including investing in programs designed to end sexual exploitation and connecting survivors to safety, justice, and opportunity, ensuring that schools provide meaningful access to guidance and career counseling, and promising leadership development opportunities for young people. Expanding the Summer Youth Employment Program to a comprehensive year-round program that provides real job skills. That provides real job skills and offers pathways to career readiness. Improving transgender healthcare services, and creating a fund for access to contraceptives. So I am very pleased to announce today that the council will allocate $10 million over the next 2 years to fund important programs recommended by the Young Women's Initiative. Even better, our partners in the philanthropic community will match this funding. This $20 million initiative will truly make a difference in the lives of young women and girls throughout New York City. Young women should be asking how, not if. Las mujeres jóvenes son la fundación, el epicentro de la esperanza de nuestra ciudad para el futuro. Young women are the very foundation, the core of our city's hope for the future. So we don't need cracks in the glass ceiling. We need to shatter it once and for all. Because she will be anything and everything she wants to be. Estamos en un momento único en la historia. We are at a unique time in our history. In New York City, the pendulum has swung from regression and exclusion to progress and inclusion. En la ciudad de Nueva York hemos logrado vencer la regresión y exclusión para abrazar el progreso y la inclusión. And as we know, when New York City leads, the world follows. Y como sabemos, cuando Nueva York lidera, el mundo nos sigue. So when we commit to improving how communities and the criminal justice system interact, when we lay out ambitious plans to help the homeless or to engage our youth, or when we stand up for our neighborhoods, immigrants, caregivers, new mothers, and young women, the world takes notice. What we do in New York matters. So we must remember we are each other's keepers, that we must care for and respect one another. Whether you live in Manhattan or Staten Island, Brooklyn, Queens, or right here in the Boogie Down Bronx. We all crowd into the same subways and buses. We all walk on the same sidewalks. And our shared humanity makes us unlike any other city in the world. New Yorkers have a symbiotic relationship, and each of us has a role to play. The beat cop on the street, the bodega owner, the lawyer, the journalist, the veteran, the carwashero, the senior, and the homeless family. They are all New Yorkers. Necesitamos más justicia. We need more justice for them. Necesitamos más justicia para nuestros niños. We need more justice for our children. Necesitamos más justicia para nuestra ciudad. And we need more justice for New York City. Pa'lante, siempre pa'lante. Thank you.
The rhyme, it is wicked. Those that don't know how to be pros get evicted. A woman could bear you, break you, take you. Now it's time to rhyme. Can you relate to a sister dope enough to make you holler and scream?
Hey, yo, let me take it from here, queen. Excuse me, but I ain't come out by due to get into precisely what I am about to do. I'm compensating to the folks who have no whatsoever clue. So listen very carefully as I break it down for you. Merrily, 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 high to happy overjoy. Please, with all the beats and rhymes my sisters have employed. Look, as you're throwing down the sound totally a yes. Let me state the position. Ladies first, yes. Cause when it's time for loving, it's the woman that gets them strong. Stepping, strutting, moving on, rhyming, cutting, and not forgetting. We are the ones to give birth to the new generation of prophets, cause it's late. I break into a lyrical freestyle. Grab the mic, look at the crowd and see smiles. Cause they see a woman standing up on her own two. Sloppy slouching is something I won't do. Some think that we can't flow.
Can't flow.
Stereotypes, they got to go.
Got to go.
I'ma mess around and flip the scene into reverse.
With what?
With a little touch of ladies first.
My mind expands throughout the universe. A female rapper with a message to send. The Queen Latifah is a perfect specimen.
My sister, can I get some?
Sure, Moni Love, grab the mic and get dumb.
Yo, praise me not for being simply what I am. Born in L-O-N-D-O and sound American. You dig exactly where I'm coming from. You want righteous rhyme and I'ma give you some. To enable you to age yourself and get paid. And the material that has no meaning I wish to play. Pay me every bit of your attention. Like mother, like daughter, I would also like to mention. I wish for you to bring me to the bring me to of which is now systematically given. Desperately stressing, I'm the daughter of a sister who's the mother of a brother who's the brother of another. Plus one more. All four have a job to do. We doing it respect due to the mother who's the root of it. And next up is me, the M-O-N-I-E-L-O-V-E. And I'm first cause I'm a L-A-D-I-E.
Contact and in fact, the style it gets harder. Cooling on the scene with my European partner. Laying down track after track, waiting for the climax. When I get there, that's when I tax the next man or the next woman. It doesn't make a difference. Keep the competition coming. And I recite chapter and verse. The title of this recital is Ladies First. On the mic, the scene is ripe, the crowd is hype. I expel the whack and those who bite. Why? Cause I'm that type. Swaying with beats 45 King style. He wants me to sing, but I'll swing. So meanwhile, a footnote for the opposite sex. Tony, yes, I'm like, come on. Yeah, you never get me at my worst.